This video contains elements that are not suitable for children under the age of 14. Viewer discretion is advised. Hey guys, I'm Sean Faye Wolf of Diamond X Studios.
And I'm Lizette G, and yep, 20 songs. We're doing this.
We're going to try and keep the intro pretty brief here because for the first time in the history of our channels, Liz and I will be discussing the top 20 best songs of this year, 1966. I feel like we don't really need to go into detail about why, considering that even when we were talking about the worst music of this year, we still spent a pretty good chunk of the time discussing what an exceptional year for music 1966 was. Not only did we have a world-class buffet of legendary music to choose from, but most of the songs in this video have already been so thoroughly embedded into pop culture as among the greatest music ever made that there's very little we could possibly add to the conversation. A very real argument can be made that 1966 is the year where popular music peaked, not just in terms of quality, but in terms of artistic innovation and influence. The British Invasion had been around for long enough to permanently evolve the definition of what pop music could be, not only inspiring new American artists to follow in their paths, but opening the door to the mainstream for established American artists who were previously too left of the dial. If the pop songs of 1962 were Atari games, the pop songs of 1966, just 4 years later, were PlayStation 2. The leap in quality and complexity is that absurdly vast.
1966 is an endlessly interesting year, one that prides itself on innovation, significance, and just plain awesomeness. Anyone who didn't know better may be tempted to conclude from our worst list that much of the popular stuff was driven by out-of-touch industry heads plainly ignorant to the colorful culture that defined so much of the mid-60s. We're here to assure you that, as bad as the worst of the year is, the best of 66 is exponentially better. Let it be known that the challenge for us here was capping it off at only 20 songs. There were a number of painful cuts we needed to make to this list and honorable mentions, if only to circumvent the undeniable temptation of covering the whole damn year-end list. With this list, we have attempted, to the best of our abilities, to highlight what we believe to be the creamiest of this entire magnificent crop.
There's no better way to celebrate the legend that was 1966 than by just showing you. So let's cut straight to the chase and take a look at
Wouldn't it be nice if we could wake up in the morning when the day is new? After having spent the day together, hold each other close the whole night through. What happy times together we'd be spending. I wish that every kiss was
Okay, so to start off this deep dive into the golden age of counterculture, hippiedom, and free love, I don't know if I can possibly think of a better way to start than with a song about how drugs are really bad for you and would probably be best if you avoided doing them. Yep, 1966 was such a badass year that even when the songs got their Nancy Reagan on, they still managed to slap. Kick it.
Don't it seem like it's just keep getting harder to find? All your kids ain't bringing you peace of mind. Before you find out it's too late, girl, you better get straight.
Paul Revere and the Raiders were one of a number of budding pop rock bands that found considerable success in the changing tides of the American music scene. One could be tempted to throw them into the pile of interchangeable bands of their ilk with their jangly guitars and poppy melodies with the gritty edge popularized by the likes of the Byrds and Rolling Stones. But you see, they're the band with the Revolutionary War style uniform, so they're way different.
Well, there's nothing better you ain't tried to fill the emptiness inside.
Seriously though, there's a lot to like about this particular record. This song was composed by renowned songwriting team Whale and Man and was initially offered to English rock band The Animals before they turned it down. Now, I love The Animals, but it's so clear that the bluesy vocals of Eric Burdon would have been no match for Kix. Mark Lindsay's vocals are the perfect kind of rough around the edges for this song, playing these pop melodies with a distinct jagged energy so definitive of this era of pop rock. Drake Levin's menacing guitar riff strings this track with such ease, and musically this demonstrates some of the plain, coolest aspects of 60s sound and production.
No, it's not with Kix. You just need help, girl.
You'd almost be tempted to think that Paul Revere and the Raiders were some of the hippest, raddest cats in the entire biz. On the contrary, well, considering that the group decided to take on an anti-drug song in the goddamn 60s, you can draw your own conclusions.
It's funny, because we rallied against Ballad of the Green Berets specifically because its success flew in the face of the revolutionary moment in history it was a part of. And you could argue that Kix does something very similar. Don't it seem like Kix just keep getting harder to find? And all your kids ain't bringing you peace of mind. Before you find out it's too late, girl, you better get straight. Not only is it obviously a staunchly anti-drug and pro-authority song in an era where social norms were being deconstructed and rewritten, but while it's technically a garage rock song, it seems much more polished and slicked up than many of its peers, and between this and that ridiculous blue coat getup, it's not surprising to me that these guys were laughed at and scorned by the youth of those days as a bunch of poser wannabe narcs. But then again, I guess that just goes to show that at the end of the day, good music is what wins out, because that's one hell of a catchy riff topped off by an instantly memorable hook, which only highlights the ominous, dire tone as Lindsay warns this girl about how she's never gonna run out of high or highs to chase, and how at the end of the day, drugs can't fix the emptiness at a person's core. Don't you see, no matter what you do, you'll never run away from here. It'd be one thing if this song just said winners don't do drugs and left it at that, but these guys actually seem to have a serious respect and understanding for what drug addiction can do to a person, as well as the real reasons why one might be tempted to travel that road in the first place. Because of all that, along with the sweet classic rock package they've chosen to wrap this message in, it's completely understandable why history has reappraised this song into the one 60s anti-drug song that actually justifies its own existence. Also, this band's founder is literally named Paul Revere Dick. That is very funny. Oh, and speaking of those rougher, scrappier garage rock songs,
let me just cut right to the chase. I love everything about this song. The gloomy, dingy atmosphere, that catchy as sin keyboard hook, these lyrics wherein the singer professes a pretty arrogant kiss-off towards his ex-partner, everything. Unlike with the stiffness of Hanky Panky, this song properly exemplifies just how passionate and playful the 60s garage rock sound could truly be. This is no less accurate regarding the band's eccentric lead vocalist, Rudy Martinez, who claimed to have been a time traveler originating from the planet Mars and who once legally changed his name to an actual question mark. You would think that this song would be a lot weirder with this background, but it's actually pretty straightforward, save for the aforementioned aspects of its garage rock identity. And you'll stop crying. 96 tears. Unlike with Hooray for Hazel, I don't get quite so many bad vibes with the not-so-graceful aspects of this particular breakup tune. This just sounds super cool, and I've always had such a great time at every instance I press play. And also a lot of pride for this being one of the few examples of Chicano representation in this era's pop charts. So there's that too.
Yeah, who would have thought that a band of children of migrant farmers headed by a dude who legally changed his name to a symbol before Prince was even 10 years old would end up spearheading one of the most revolutionary and critically acclaimed genres in the history of music. And no, I'm not actually talking about garage rock here. While this song is one of the definitive garage rock classics, 96 Tears is arguably just as notable for being the genesis point of the entire genre of punk rock. When the Ramones and the Sex Pistols crashed onto the scene in the mid-70s with a drive to reject the bloated stixification of rock and return it to its scrappy DIY roots, people started to wonder where this new spirit had come from, and pretty much all the retrospectives pointed to 96 Tears as the first big hit made with that same level of young, wild-eyed rambunction. This song literally sounds like it was made in someone's garage by someone with rudimentary skills on equipment that they didn't know how to professionally operate, but that gave it a level of personality and ear-catching grit that only accented the absolutely killer tune these kids were lucky enough to stumble onto. You're always laughing way down at me, but watch out now. live in a world today where lo-fi aesthetics are an incredibly common and well-respected production choice, and it's become so popular specifically because it conveys a level of down-to-earth relatability and rejection of commercialized slickness that 96 Tears managed to capture without even trying. We truly can't sing its praises enough. It's easily the best garage rock hit of the year, and the fact that it only barely managed to squeak its way onto this list, well, buckle your seatbelts, that's all I have to say.
Hello, folks! Time to tackle the first of many iconic legends to be featured throughout this list.
Yep, the time has come. Let's pay our dues and give our respect to one of the most revolutionary names in the history of folk rock. And also Art Garfunkel. I am a rock, I am an
island. Okay, joking aside, there's a solid argument to be made for the musical pairing of Paul Simon and Art Garfunkel to equate that of Lennon McCartney as quite an important part of the 60s sound as we know it. I Am a Rock may not be one of their most instantly recognizable recordings in this day and age, but the duo's distinctly dense harmonies in particular surely stand among their countless shining moments throughout this era.
Yeah, if I had to describe Art Garfunkel with three words, those three words would be good at harmonizing. I have no need of friendship. Friendship causes pain. Okay, joking aside for real this time, folk rock was arguably just as important to the grand tapestry of the 60s as any of the flashier and more exciting genres surrounding it. And there's a reason Simon and Garfunkel are synonymous with the genre to this day. I Am a Rock does at a glance seem a bit middling in their discography, being less iconic than Bridge Over Troubled Water, less exciting and complex than The Boxer, and less haunting and austere than Scarborough Fair. However, when there's beauty and simplicity, you can trust Paul Simon to be the one to find it. And this song achieves it with quite possibly the most bluntly effective eight words you could possibly hope to build a chorus out of. I am a rock. I am an island. I am a rock. I am an island. I am immovable, I am unflinching, and nothing but the sands of time themselves can wear me away. It's the most basic simile you could possibly think of, and yet it does its job better than any more ornate words possibly could. The rest of the song also keeps straight to the point, as the narrator describes all the ways he's completely shut down, hiding in his shell and embracing his numbness to the world around him, refusing to open up to anyone lest he gets hurt. In a world of beautiful love songs, winding story ballads, and uplifting calls for transcendence, it's nice to know that the people of 1966 still had a good, healthy appreciation for crushing antisocial introversion. Frankly, I'm already losing count of all the ways this year was forward-thinking. And an island never
cries. Call me Fart. Fart Garfunkel. But you can call me Fart Garfunkel.
And now, time for the single best Fab Four hits from the entirety of 1966. Well, at least according to me.
In the town where I was born, lived a man who sailed to sea.
Okay, hear me out.
We all live in a yellow submarine, yellow submarine, yellow submarine.
Look, here's the thing. I love the Beatles as much as the next nerd posing as a music historian out there. I see and appreciate their place in the pop music timeline as the biggest force that shifted the fabric of popular music in the 60s, and it certainly helped that the music from this was often quite good. To enumerate even a brief list of their biggest hits would be a lesson in futility. You're watching this video, so I think you already know the drill. However, I'm here to sing my praises for this oft-rejected cut in this era of the Beatles' career. It's not like I don't get the general reaction to Yellow Submarine, ranging from apathy to just plain distaste. It's a literal children's song, and the first of the band's singles to be sung by drummer Ringo Starr. It eschews the band's then-usual tendency towards the Merseybeat sound, instead shifting into an experimental hodgepodge of childish instrumentals, nautical sound, and messy chatter. And, well, let's just say that the fact that this release shared an A-side with the lush and beautiful Eleanor Rigby must have come to a shock to Beatles fans, who were then treated to lyrics as goofy as these. But the thing is, I find Yellow Submarine absolutely delightful. While I enjoy the earlier Beatles super hits like I Want to Hold Your Hand and Hard Day's Night as much as the next person, nearly 60 years later, they feel like slightly antiquated, almost boring relics of this particular time frame. They're solid, sure, but it's also very clear just how they must have been so exciting for such a low standards crowd as early 60s pop listeners. Yellow Submarine, though, sounds like little else the Beatles had ever done before and since. Its playfulness is off the charts, and that repetitive chorus practically beckons to be sung by a room full of swaying companions. I think I tend to have a soft spot for songs with this type of unbridled innocence, such as Puff the Magic Dragon, and even Ringo's later composition, Octopus's Garden. And the charm that vibrates from Yellow Submarine is pretty similar. To put it another way, while the Beatles' absolute best work has me concentrating on their exceptional lyricism and mind-blowing sonic innovation, Yellow Submarine is a sunny reminder that sometimes things don't have to be quite as profound. In the words of those other Beatles, haters mad for whatever reason. But that's okay, because we all live in a yellow submarine.
We all live in a yellow submarine. Yellow submarine. Yellow submarine.
And now for the real best Fab Four hit of 1966. You know, according to me, at least. So yeah, the real one.
We can work it out. We can work it out. Think of what you're saying.
Okay, let me get this out of the way now. This is the only other Beatles song that's going to be appearing on this list. Yes, they had two other hits on this year-end list, making this an uncharacteristically slow year for them, actually. And yes, they're both excellent, but no, they didn't manage to make it onto this list. I too think it's absolutely mind-blowing that no Beatles songs made it into the top 15. But hey, we weren't the ones who decided to make this year so ridiculously fucking stacked, okay?
Do I have to keep on talking till I can go?
So what makes this particular Beatles song so great? Well, I mean, apart from the fact that Lennon, McCartney, and Martin simply pumped out great-sounding pop songs literally faster than I'm able to make videos discussing them, We Can Work It Out stands out because while Paperback Writer is very particular and interesting, Nowhere Man explores darker and more somber directions, and Yellow Submarine is obviously its own thing entirely, We Can Work It Out is the most basic pop song of anything the Fab Four put out in 66. And I'm not at all surprised that it was their biggest hit of the year.
I have always thought that it's a crime.
It takes that same basicness Liz talked about that endeared them so deeply to the radio-listening public of the early 60s, and evolves it just a step further, holding on to the simplicity while also tinging it with small hints of the complexity with which they would seismically rupture the world of pop music just 1 year later. It's also notably one of their first big peace-and-love sing-along type dealies, which would become synonymous with the band as years went on. But while the positivity is what tends to get all of the attention, the majority of the song is actually spent focused on how at odds this couple are with each other.
While you see it your way, run the risk of knowing that our love may soon be gone. You can get it wrong and still you think that it's alright. There's a chance that we might fall apart before too long.
Honestly, in context, McCartney saying we can work it out over and over again seems like he's trying to convince himself more than anything else. Not that you'd notice because of how buoyant and uplifting the chorus and verses sound. The bridge is honestly the only part where the cynicism becomes unavoidable and obvious, mostly because McCartney asked Lennon to help him connect the song together, and Lennon felt the need to throw a bit of cold water on the song's buoyancy. If nothing else, the song is a pretty distinctive showcase of the difference between Lennon and McCartney's songwriting styles, because it's not at all difficult to pinpoint the exact moment where McCartney stopped writing and Lennon started.
We can work it out. We can work it out.
It's cool, man. Got red bottoms on. His life is
very short and there's no time.
However interesting these observations might be, though, at the end of the day, they're just window dressing. This song is on the list because it's a pretty by-the-numbers pop song from arguably the greatest and inarguably the most influential band in modern history. Whether you take it as an introspective rumination or an uplifting sing-along, I seriously doubt anyone is going to dispute this song deserves to be here. This next song may not be the most outstanding or envelope-pushing hit of 1966, but if I had to point to just one song this year that demonstrates just how drastically the standards for pop music improved in the wake of the British invasion, it would be this one.
Bus stop wet day, she's there, I say, please share my umbrella.
Out of all the UK acts who crossed into America in the 60s, the Hollies were at the crest of the wave in terms of success, but not influence. They didn't score their best remembered song, Long Cool Woman in a Black Dress, until 1972. And despite their high number of top 10 hits in the back end of the 60s, they've mostly been remembered as just another 60s rock band. Really, though, that's what was so incredible about the late 60s. It was a time when just your average run-of-the-mill band had a reasonable chance of churning out some of the most stone-cold classics in the history of rock.
That umbrella, we employed it by August, she was mine.
The Hollies had their most consistent success as yet another post-skiffle band riding off the coattails of the British invasion, and I've always personally preferred their 70s material after founding member Graham Nash departed the group to form the illustrious Crosby, Stills, and Nash. It was at this point where the band's sound became richer and much more interesting to me. Check out The Air That I Breathe, one of my favorite songs ever, and thank me later. With that said, I also can't deny that there's something particularly nice and sweet about this era of their sound. The guitars are always really nice, as is certainly the case in Bus Stop, with its jaunty chords and sunny melodies, but what is particularly of note in this case are the sharp, distinct harmonies from the group. As simple of a pop song this may seem at its surface, this is elevated once the chorus kicks in and their vocals really start to shine.
Every morning I would see her waiting at the stop. Sometimes she'd shop and she would show me what she'd bought.
This is the type of colorful performance that I can find to be sorely lacking in their contemporaries, like, for example, Herman's Hermits, who I never really liked much. Bus Stop, on the contrary, is endlessly charming and so effectively captures the cultural vibrations to be found in the best of the British invasion. Not too bad from a tune that essentially just divulges the tale of a budding romance at the titular bus stop.
That's the way the whole thing started. Silly, but it's true. I'm thinking of a sweet romance.
Tritone harmonies are certainly one of the Hollies' trademarks. The influence of the early Beatles on these kids is impossible to ignore, but the lyrics are what really caused this song to stick in my mind. There's nothing particularly standout about any of them on their own, but the concept of this romance blooming between two young people who fall in love over several months of daily chit-chat at the bus stop they both frequent is just a novel concept for a song.
All the people stared as if we were both quite insane. Someday my name
He talks about giving her shelter under his umbrella, hearing her talk about the things she's bought, and slowly falling in love with her over the winter. And the tone of it reminds me of when my grandma reminisces about meeting my grandpa as a young woman and bonding with him over their shared love of sports cars. Just a really cute story that might seem mundane at a glance, but really hits you hard when you realize that these little moments that we take for granted have the power to kickstart something as beautiful as a lifelong love.
Came the sun, the ice was melting. No more sheltering now. Nice to think that that umbrella led me to a vow.
That's cute. I love that. This is a good song. So we already went on and on about the Beatles and how their influence was all over everything this year, and that theme is going to continue for the rest of this countdown. So it kind of makes you wonder, where were the Beatles getting their inspiration from?
What a day for a daydream. What a day for a daydreaming boy.
So far, we've covered some ground with the presence of both polished British pop rock and fuzzier garage rock on 1966 pop charts, but we have yet to definitively cover one of the biggest influences to the sound of the 60s. You know, hippies. In particular, the mid to late 60s saw a lot of popular music that tended to dabble in sweet poppy melodies, but with more of a rustic, bohemian edge to it all. The Mamas and the Papas are probably the most prominent example as such, at least in this year. But we'd also be remiss to pay mention to one of the other leading folk pop acts at the time, that being the Lovin' Spoonful. It's a bit difficult to create an elevator pitch summation on what these guys' material was all about, as it wasn't uncommon for their overall vibe to fluctuate from song to song. Their other two hits from this year, Did You Ever Have to Make Up Your Mind and Summer in the City, are damn near polar opposites in terms of sound and atmosphere. But then we have Daydream, which lies in that golden middle ground between hazy and oh so catchy.
I'm blowing the day to take a walk in the sun and follow my face on somebody's new mode law.
It's hard not to be in a great mood when I listen to this song. The smooth strumming and playful percussion effortlessly bring to mind the thoughts of some of the laziest, most tranquil summer days in my immediate memories. It's got everything I could ever want in a song like this. An instantly memorable melody line, understated production, a slightly psychedelic edge, a whistling break. Much of this is thanks to the primary singer-songwriter of the group, John Sebastian, who has a real knack for crafting songs on the jollier, even childish side of things. This is a tough line to straddle, but in my opinion at least, Daydream gets it absolutely 100% right. Ultimately, Daydream is the perfect title for it in general, overflowing with good positive feelings and guaranteed to put a smile on my face in even my most sour of moods.
I'm lost in a daydream.
And jarring tone shift in 5, 4, 17, 18.
Here it comes, here it comes, here it comes.
The Beatles and the Rolling Stones were the two-pronged spearhead of the British invasion. While the Fab Four revolutionized popular music as an umbrella genre and expanded it into more experimental and artsier directions, the Stones were foundational pioneers of hard rock who showed the world that good vibes and playful energy weren't required for a song to capture the world's attention. Morbid story ballads and songs about unpleasant subject matter have been commonplace popular music since the very beginning, but they were typically presented with a wink and a nod, smothering their dark subject matter in a thick layer of chintz and sunshine to prevent the words from really sinking in. Enter the Rolling Stones, and suddenly you've got a parade of top five hits about how the world is a dark, evil, and scary place, all of which sound just as scary as they read. 19th Nervous Breakdown is honestly pretty sonically upbeat for a Stones record. They would release Painted Black just 4 months later. But the only reason for this is because it's a song about Mick Jagger celebrating a woman losing her mind.
You always fought with a thousand toys, but still you ride on.
Okay, maybe celebrating is the wrong word, his relation to this girl is up to interpretation, but he does go into great detail about how she was brought up in a life of material privilege and emotional neglect, how she's cold and distant following several bad relationships, and how all of Mick's attempts to help her just led to her dragging him down with her.
Well, nothing I do don't seem to work.
So, in this song, is Mick warning her to calm down and self-reflect to avoid having yet another episode, or is he celebrating the suffering of someone who he's sick of trying to help when she clearly isn't taking it? Who's to say? All I can tell you is that this level of lyrical detail, while still maintaining that flexibility, makes this song endlessly re-listenable. Thanks to one of Jagger and Richard's all-time best compositions, with particularly great bass work by Bill Wyman. And all topped off by one of the most memorable choruses in the history of rock.
Here it comes. Here it comes. Here comes your 90s nervous breakdown.
19th Nervous Breakdown by the Rolling Stones. A furious scream of frustration at a fruitless attempt to help someone in need, or a dude punching down at a woman in need of serious help? The answer to that question is that it's a hard rock classic, so who the hell cares? I mean, it's not like you're gonna stop listening to it.
Here comes your 19th nervous breakdown.
And by the way, you know what else was happening in 1966? Motown. Yeah, because God knows this era just wasn't stacked enough.
Motown Motown Records in its golden era gave the world a truly amazing lineup of legendary hitmakers to call their own, and to name one act that rises above all others would be damn near impossible. Nonetheless, with an impressive 12 number one Hot 100 singles under their belt, I think a good case could be made for the Supremes. Led by the dynamic Diana Ross with Florence Ballard and Mary Wilson on backup, the Supremes were undoubtedly one of the single most consistent musical groups of their time. And just a skim through their 60s discography makes it abundantly clear why. The recordings are replete with hooks that are instant all-timers, led by some of the most spirited pop R&B production of its time, and such is the case with their 8th chart topper, You Keep Me Hanging On, which sure is a bit more low-key than much of their other stuff, but still kicks just as hard. Let me get over you. The sing-along melody is great, and Ross, Ballard, and Wilson kill it here, as always. But I've got to give some special attention to the backup instrumentalists, known collectively as the Funk Brothers, who are essentially Motown's version of the Wrecking Crew. The telegram-like guitars at the introduction is such an inspired choice, creating a tense atmosphere that carries on throughout the rest of the song's theme of all-too-real post-breakup English. This is just one hell of a pop song, one that digs its hooks in and refuses to leave quite so quickly.
The Supremes' recording of this song is an all-time classic of the Motown era, and I would personally go as far as to say that this is even better than their other monster hit from this year, You Can't Hurry Love. But what made me really recognize what a masterpiece this song was is the legacy that it left behind. Because not 2 years after this song hit number one, a cover by proto-metal band Vanilla Fudge hit the top 10 with a cover that lowered the tempo, jacked up the intensity, and created an all-time classic psychedelic garage rock banger in the process. You really don't want me. But of course, this isn't the song's only legacy. A good number of you probably know this song best from Kim Wilde's 1987 cover, which turned this into one of just a handful of songs that went to number one for two different artists. I mean, sure, this particular cover may be more than a bit dated, but the bass appeal is strong as ever, and the constant building and self-resolving chord structure slots into the high-energy format perfectly. And as if that weren't enough, this song actually hit the top 10 for a fourth time in 1995, albeit on the dance charts, thanks to a cover by Reba Friggin' McEntire, of all people. And surprise, surprise, it slaps harder than a roid raging Batman. Get on. Honestly, I think the song's quality kind of speaks for itself at this point. If you have a composition that's been a Motown soul cut, a lo-fi slice of psychedelic proto-metal, an 80s EDM classic, and a country-tinged dance floor smash, and it kicked ass every single time, that tells me that it's just a fundamentally strong composition at its core, and the Supremes' original is one of the defining songs of Motown's golden era that easily earns its place among the greatest music of the greatest year. Let me sleep at night. Turns out there was actually another Stone Cold classic from this year that hit number one for two different artists, but then again, one of those artists was Michael Bolton, so... yeah. When a man loves a woman, can't keep his mind on nothing else.
He changed the world for the good things. As if we needed any further example after the last entry of just how solid the soul and R&B side of the airwaves were in 1966, here comes Percy Sledge and his million-dollar vocals to firmly cement this in once and for all. It's no surprise how this song has shown up on numerous retro soul compilations through the years. The sound of the song is just so seductive. The lonesome organ from the start has this incredibly warm tone to it, lending to the romantic atmosphere of the entire song. And yeah, like I mentioned, Percy Sledge wastes no time in pouring his whole heart out from the very first declaration of that title phrase. I initially brought this song up in contrast to the fruitless fragility of Almost Persuaded. Whereas that song is weak and despondent, When a Man Loves a Woman leaves an impression with each and every listen. What kind of impression, of course, is up to how much overflow of messy emotions one opts to endure in that particular particular moments. And believe me when I say that this song is messy. From the first few lines, it seems as though Sledge is simply pouring his undying admiration to the love of his life, with whom he shares a lasting, unbreakable bond. Pretty quickly though, some cracks start to form in this facade. In fact, an unrequited love we're talking about here, or at the very least, a relationship that might have had a spark of romance at some point, but one that has long since dimmed out, for her at least. The tragedy here is that Percy continues to give his all, as much as his unconditional loyalty may cause serious distress in the long run. Soft spot for tragic love stories such as this, so this hits that particular button for me personally. Also in general, it's just one hell of a mighty performance, and one that couldn't be ignored by either of us. If she played for a fool, he's the last one to know.
Loving eyes can never see. Well, we obviously love the Motown hits of this era to death. Those songs were still meticulously crafted in the studio for mass appeal, whereas Percy Sledge has managed to find the true root of soul music here, in that he is bearing his soul for the world to see, with no filter, no reservations, no attempts to hide the raging fire in his belly as he ruminates on the nature of love as one of the most powerful driving forces a human being can experience. Frankly, I'd be lying if I said I wanted to listen to this song very often purely because of how exhausted I feel by the end of listening to it, but at the end of the day, music is a form of art. The purpose of art is to capture something and make you feel. And to that end, Percy Sledge managed to cut through the capitalist pop machine for a brief moment and bless us with one of the most heartbreakingly human songs in the history of pop culture. I'm just glad that we were wise enough to accept him.
How come Batman doesn't dance anymore? Remember the bat to see?
Yo, hey, yeah, yeah. I know what.
Nice meeting you. Just keep moving. Don't make eye contact.
Do the walk to see. That's my little Lucy.
No, we're not kidding. 1966 had its own Watch Me by Silento, and it kicks ass. Because 1966.
Wilson Pickett was one hell of a performer who always understood the assignment. In this case, he attempts to create a record completely constructed by boundless party energy, throwing out references to popular dances of the day amidst hyped up vocalizations and an instantly memorable vocal line. I'd say this was a wild success.
I need your strength, I need your tender touch.
My God, Diana Ross has such a beautiful voice. In any other year, this would be a strong contender for the top five, easy.
The barest of bare-bones garage rock imaginable, and yet incredibly badass in ways that is hard to pinpoint exactly. Maybe it's the guitar riff? Yeah, it's probably the guitar riff.
It's based on a novel by a man named Lear, and I need a job, so I wanna be a paperback writer.
This is a classic Beatles song about a young man chasing after his passions of being an author while growing frustrated working with an editor and trying to land a fair publishing contract. I don't know what it is, but this song, it just speaks to me. Also, it's incredibly funny to me that even back in 1966, people knew what a worthless rag the Daily Mail was. Oh, yeah, and this was also the year John Lennon said the Beatles were more popular than Jesus, which got them banned from half the country's radio stations, made people burn their records in the street, and had the Ku Klux Klan picketing outside their concerts.
Cool!
But I would not feel so all alone.
Okay, Okay, yeah, this is pretty repetitive and hokey and sloppy, and yes, I know it's not the best opener to one of the greatest albums of Bob Dylan's whole career. At the same time, though, it essentially encapsulates everything I love about the free-spirited, improvisational art revolutions that make up a huge part of the 60s personality. So of course I'm always gonna love this. Oh, and by the way guys, did you know that 12 times 35 is 420?
Home, where my thoughts escaping home. When my music's playing.
Is it sacrilegious to say I like Bon Jovi's take on nostalgic homesickness better than this? Yeah, screw it, this is still fantastic.
Stevie Wonder was one of those artists whose career got some more meat in their bones in the 70s, but this is probably one of his best early records, with that tight Motown production fitting Wonder's decidedly majestic vocals like a glove. Kind of amazing that he was only 15 years old upon its release.
Secret Agent Man, Secret Agent Man.
Goldfinger released in 1964 and raked in over $100 million, so you'd be crazy if you didn't think there'd be at least one pop song capitalizing on the James Bond phenomenon. And thankfully, Johnny Rivers' Secret Agent Man has stood the test of time as one of the slickest, most endearing novelties of the entire decade. I unironically love this. The hook is absolutely killer, and once you hear it, you are never gonna forget it.
They giving you a number and taking away your name.
Oh, Boston, you're my home. You're the number one place.
That heady guitar riff pretty much drives this entire song, sure. But boy, is it sticky. I've never been to Boston, but I'd imagine that this very song plays loudly the second anyone from anywhere else sets foot on Boston soil. Interesting that, considering that the Standals themselves are from California and none of the members had ever even been to Boston prior to recording this song. Sometimes it all just works out.
Just walk away, Renee. You won't see me follow you back home.
An oft-forgotten trend of the second half of the 60s came in the form of something called Baroque pop, which is exactly what it sounds like. Contemporary pop performance and production imbued with classical elements resulting in a purposefully atypical vibe. Pet Sounds is a famous example of this, but Walk Away Renee is possibly the first hit to come from the genre. The harpsichord running throughout the song feels absolutely gorgeous, set alongside these lyrics of heartache and longing toward memories of times past. In case you somehow aren't convinced of the innovation and sound and quality to come from the 60s, give this one a listen and bask in some true vibes.
And last but not least, let the record show that ridiculous novelties were not a dead art in 1966, even in spite of all the insane development going on in all directions around them. Frankly, I can't think of a better illustration of the novelty refusing to die than the fact that this song went to number one for a single week, then got knocked off the top spot by Good Vibrations, only for Winchester Cathedral to knock the Beach Boys right back off the top spot the week after that. What a legendary tune.
Winchester Cathedral.
And that'll do for part one of this video, and just like the worst list, part two will be premiering tomorrow, same time on Lizette's channel. The premiere is now live, and you can find a link to the video in the description as well as the pinned comment. Before we go, we do have five of my lucky patrons who have been randomly selected to give their thoughts on the music of this year, so let's turn it over to them. From Night Browser regarding I Am a Rock, judging from the title alone, I thought this would be something sillier compared to what I was usually expecting from Simon and Garfunkel, not an emotional lament of bitterness from isolating yourself after a failed relationship. Pretty good stuff. From XJ May regarding Yellow Submarine.
My parents and grandparents would just occasionally play Beatles records for me when I was a kid. Mainly my grandparents did. And Yellow Submarine was one of two songs I distinctly remember hearing a lot. The other was Here Comes the Sun. So yeah, I have pretty good memories of it. I also vaguely remember watching the movie, but not super, super well. It's a good song. I like it a lot.
From Brad Reigner regarding When a Man Loves a Woman. Like many children of the 90s, I had the misfortune to learn about this song via the Michael Bolton cover rather than the Percy Sledge original. To me, there's no comparison between the two. As much as Bolton tries to milk the song emotionally with his embellishments and that endless outro, I don't buy that he's ever experienced real heartbreak before. He just comes off like a guy in a recording studio who's getting paid to sing a love song. When I hear Sledge sing this song, I get a sense that not only is he genuinely in love, but that he's vulnerable. When he says he'd give up his money, his friends, and his entire world just for the hope of achieving lasting love, not only do I believe his words, but I'm convinced that he's been there before. From Triple Nine, Brian regarding You Keep Me Hanging On?
Hot take, but I always felt like Diana Ross didn't have the kind of powerful vocals that the song really feels like it should have. Maybe that's just me, though.
And last but not least, from Siska Sinatria regarding Land of a Thousand Dances, this is probably one of the lushest and most dense dance records, and easily one of the best in its subgenre. Also, watch the Just Dance gameplay of this song with a VTuber in the thumbnail. Trust me, you won't regret it. And with that, I think we're about ready to wrap up. Again, be sure to head over to Lizette's channel, where the premiere for part 2 of this video is now live. It'll be happening tomorrow, so make sure you head over there and set a reminder, and while you're at it, you may as well subscribe to Lizette's channel. I mean, it definitely couldn't hurt, especially if you enjoy pop music discussion.
Thank you so much for watching. This has been a lot of fun so far, and we can't wait to show you what we think are the very best hits from this legendary year of 1966. I'm Lizette G, and I'll see you all next time.
I'm Sean Faye Wolf of Diamond X Studios, doing a top 20 list is exhausting, and I'm probably never going to do it again, but damn it, this year was worth it. See you next time.